On behalf of Linda and the entire Dutchendorf family, I want to say thank you for coming. Your presence is a great encouragement to help the family make it through today and into the future. I'd like to ask you to bow your heads now as we ask for God's presence in our service this morning. Father God, our words cannot express the deep need we have for you to be present with us. We ask for your help. We ask for your reassurance. We ask for your peace, for your comfort, your joy, and your everlasting hope. Be with Linda. Be with the Dutchendorf family. And Father, as we honor John's memory today, we pray that you would help us turn our sorrow into joy. And may the faith that we have in you, our Creator and our Savior, be greater than any sorrow that we feel. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We're going to sing a song of celebration, I'll Fly Away. It's one the family chose. Now, I heard Scott tell me this morning, now Linda said there's no crying allowed. And he said, yeah, right, Mom. That's going to be a tough one to fulfill. But I'm going to ask the family to remain seated as we, and the rest of us, as we have come to surround this family today and lift them up. I'm going to ask you to stand. Family, you remain seated, and we're going to stand because it's much easier to sing All Fly Away. Some of you are kind of crammed in there. So go ahead, stand up, and let's sing All Fly Away, as John would want us to sing. Seated. Thank you.
Good morning, Linda. I'll introduce myself because I look like a stranger here. It was my joy to marry into the Heiderbrecht family 44 years ago. And so we're from Oregon, my wife and I, and I've been a pastor for many years. And so it's my joy to participate a little bit in this service this morning. I loved John, and I guess the family called, and that's how I learned to call him a Johnny Dale. And I'll just share one little story before we do some reading of scripture from his Bible. people. It was about 20 years ago, maybe more, where I invited Johnny Dale to come out to Oregon and to build me a building. And 20 by 24 or 24 by 28, I'm not so good with numbers, but it is still beautiful. And so we have the privilege in our family every day seeing one of the long-lasting, useful and beautiful buildings built by John and other relatives and people who knew what they're doing. I serve the lemonade. One more little memory is the first time I came out here to Oklahoma to visit all this clan, the Heiderbrechts, the Dutchendorfs, and everything. I think it was late 70s. We had to go to a stock car race because Johnny was driving. And I don't know what beater he was driving, but it was a beater. And when he came to Oregon, he took us to the midget races, which I had never been, but was very close to us. What an interesting, loving, fun man. I'm going to read some passages of scripture from his Bible, and I'm going to begin with his favorite verse from Proverbs 3. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make your paths straight. This is what Jesus said. I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? Was his question to Martha. This is from the Apostle Paul, Romans 8, 1. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit of life set me free from the law of sin and death. There's no condemnation. And Jesus said again to his disciples, do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I'm going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I'm going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you're going. How can we know the way? And Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Also from Romans 8, and I read this today because it's the passage that spoke to me the deepest when my own father died. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God. That's in Christ Jesus our Lord. nothing separates us from His love. And finally, again, the Apostle Paul in 2 Corinthians 5, 1 through 10. Now we know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, an eternal house in heaven, not built by human hands. Meanwhile, we groan, longing to be clothed with our heavenly dwelling. Because when we're clothed, we will not be found naked. For while we are in this tent, we groan and are burdened, because we do not wish to be unclothed, but to be clothed with our heavenly dwelling, so that what is mortal may be swallowed up by life. Now it is God who has made us for this very purpose, and has given us the Spirit as a deposit, guaranteeing what is to come. Therefore, we're always confident and know that as long as we're at home in the body, we're away from the Lord. We live by faith, not by sight. We're confident, I say, and would prefer to be away from the body and at home with the Lord. So we make it our goal to please Him, whether at home in the body or away from it. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive what's due him for the things done while in the body, whether good or bad. May God bless His holy word.
First Thessalonians 4:17 says, we will be caught up to be with the Lord forever. We're going to sing again. I'm going to let you remain seated. We're going to sing when we all get to heaven. What a day of rejoicing that will be. Robin will sing all four verses. Not a good one to skip.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus. Sing His mercy and His grace. Every day.
John Dale Dutchendorf was born in Cordell on September the 7th, 1947. The son of Fred and Vera Heidebrecht Dutchendorf. And John passed away on Tuesday, October 5th, 2021, into the arms of his Savior. He married Linda Weir. Is it Weir or Wire? Okay, Weir Wire on on Weir on May 18th, 1968. And together they had three children, Scott, Joe, and Teresa. The family moved to Hennessy in 1981. He worked in the oil field for a short time building landfills. He then started Hennessy Metal Buildings and built metal buildings in Oklahoma and the surrounding states until his retirement. He was an active member of Dover Christian Church, where he served as an elder. It's one thing to think about John and the things that he did in life, and he did a lot, but it's another to consider who he was. So yesterday, I spent some time with seven family members, including Linda and Joe, and asked them to tell me who he was in one words or phrases. Listen to this. This is whose memory we celebrate. A good man, honest, passionate. He loved his family. He loved the Lord. He loved spending time with his grandchildren. He was a loving son. He never spoke critically of others, was seldom upset, dependable, generous. He helped many, many people. Some didn't know he helped them. Courageous, faithful. He was a giver to the community, the church, to world missions. Hard working, never wavered from hard work. Funny, even goofy. Bear hugs, stubborn, hated yard work. Loved deeply by God, his family, the church, and the community. John is survived by his wonderful wife, Linda, two sons, Scott Dutchendorf and his wife, Teresa of Fairview, Joe Dutchendorf and his wife, Danielle of Pflugerville, Texas, Pflugerville, a daughter, Teresa Huggaboom, and her husband, Damian de Hennessy. Seven grandchildren, Bailey Kopach and her family, Nick, Braden Dutchendorf, Quinn Dutchendorf and his wife, Jane, Devin Dutchendorf, Hillary Huggaboom, Gage Huggaboom, Zane Huggaboom, and Callie Sager and his wife and his sister, Phyllis Whipf. He was preceded in death by his parents and a brother-in-law, Don Whipf. And I'm going to close with a memory that some of you experienced exactly at the same moment that I did almost 2 years ago. John officiated his mom's funeral about 2 years ago, Vera, and it was my privilege to be there. Toward the end of the message, he said that Vera had told him many times that the happiest day of her life was when she gave her life to the Lord Jesus Christ. She was 14 years old. But John continued to develop that idea, and he said that toward the end of her life, she was suffering a lot and was very discouraged and look forward to heaven. Of course, John provided lots of care for her, as did others. But once she passed, he said it was that day, the day she passed, that was really the best day of her life. For she was in the presence of Jesus walking on streets of gold. For John, one could easily say that October 5th was the worst day of his life. But let's think deeper. Let's think higher. I believe John would say today, from his heavenly home, that it was the best day, because by God's grace and mercy and love, he's walking those same streets of gold.
I too was just asked to share just a little bit before I sing a song about John. Some may not remember because it's been a little ways back, about 40 years ago. John was starting this business and needed some help. At that time, his own family members weren't old enough, and Teresa hadn't married a good hand to come into the family. So John, somehow I cannot remember where our paths crossed, but I ended up working with John building buildings for a while. And what a blessing that was. Since then, John has just, we've continued to be in each other's paths and lives, and it's been nothing but a tremendous blessing. One, serving in this church with him as elder. And I can tell this church family, as I will be sharing with them, we all know and experience the love John had for his church family. But I also know the love that he had for this family. So many times we saw the compassion that John had for so many, as Chuck just read about. Me being in my propane business, John and Archie Harris were the first ones, about this time of the year, would always show up at my office and sit there with Christy and talk about, do you know anybody that needs any help? Even if we didn't know anybody, there was money that changed hands, because his compassion would come in the sense of cash, just to help somebody that needed possibly food or needed heat for their home. And John and Archie were hand in hand all the time. I'd like to have got them there. We'd have got a lot more money if we could have made it an auction, see who was going to win. But they'd come at different times, and it didn't matter. They had it come from their heart. And I see Larry back here. I know Larry was another one that was blessed so much by getting to work with John, because he definitely taught us work ethic. Although, Larry, I don't know about you, I don't remember us going to eat as often as I see these guys going to eat. And you did get to make a Hawaii trip, didn't you? Two of them. You got both of those? I missed out. I was the older guy, the younger guy at that time and just starting. But another thing that I saw John at our elders meeting every night. John, this truck that he has now, he loved that truck. And I thought it was very appropriate when I went over there last night and was visiting with the boys and walked in the living room. They're all watching the races. John loved the races. Well, it wasn't a race on the home from elders meeting, but Steve Matthews and I both thought, we just got to where we let John leave first, because he would blow us away on the way home in his Talladega truck. That's what I called it. I'm like, John, are you really in that hurry to get home? Steve texted me one night, said, I left early, did you? And I said, no, I didn't. He said, well, he sure blew past me. But we will always remember that of John and wanting to get there and get home quick. We loved his humor in the elders meeting. There's not an elder, I'm not sure where they're all sitting around here, that we just loved having John serve with us as an elder. There's one thing that I do remember about John, and again, I had the greatest respect and admiration for John, and it meant something to me whenever I would start to say something and I would finish a statement, and John would say, I agree with Jimmy. Boy, I felt good. But you know what happened? It was always, I agree with Jimmy, but... But you know what? Everything that he added was always worth listening. Whenever he spoke, we listened. even if it was an addition to one of our own statements, because he was going to add something that was very fitting and appropriate at the time. And we loved serving with him. I'm going to go ahead and, well, there's another thing I remember about John. And I'd like to just see a number of hands. How many people here have a building built by John Dutchendorf for these guys? All over the place. And just as Chuck said, I enjoy going to my building, and John always appreciated mine. If you know, we've called it the gathering place. I think I finally got it to where I want it, because these guys came back twice after the first erection of the 40 by 60. Then we added on a lean-to, and then we added on another lean-to. He was back several times. But he loved coming, and he loved the fact that his building was being used to reach out and share the compassion of Christ, or just seeing people and families get together. He loved that. So each one of us know, if you're one of those blessed ones that just raise your hand, not only did John Dutchendorf build your building, he built a relationship. Everybody that I've ever known that John Dutchendorf built a building for, it wasn't all about the building, but it was a relationship and the friendship that he established with every single one of us that he built a building for. I thought it again very appropriate today that the family, when they got here, we purchased this property north of us, and that building back there that is now known as our youth room, I don't know when it was, but years ago, he built that building for Donnie Collins. And today, that's where the family met. So those buildings not only are going to continue to be such a precious memory in our minds and how we use them and being able to walk in there and just remember the presence of the builder, but also the friendship and the relationship that we got to share with John Dutchendorf. What a blessing he was to each one of us, and especially this church and this family. So John run a race, I know, several times, and he finished it well. But there's a song that Linda chose, and we can only be thankful that John has accepted and he's gone to rest high on that mountain. I'm not sure.
Sweet voice sing.
I find a peace today in knowing where John is at. One Friday, I showed up for work on a building, and John let me know, said, we're going to take off about noon. I've got to go to a family reunion. And I'm like, woohoo, I get off early today. And then he goes on to tell me, he said, I'm going to go see my cousin, John Denver. I said, yeah, right. Well, you know, he come back on Monday morning with a picture of John Denver, because his family knows John Denver's real name is John Duchendorf. So something tells me when I sang that line, can't wait to see the sweet angel's face when they heard him sing. John Duchendorf is singing just like John Denver today. There is heck of a duet happening. Actually, it's probably a trio, because his good friend Archie is in there singing his part. So anyway, we can smile and rejoice today that we know where John is at. And he does have a sweet voice today, singing just like his amazing cousin.
So go rest high on that mountain. Sign your work on earth is done. Go to for the Father and the Son.
John was a friend. I knew him as a sincere Christian. And I loved serving with him as a fellow elder here at Dover Christian Church. I liked his gentle, quiet smile. He didn't talk a lot, but he was kind of like E.F. Hutton. You know, when he spoke, you better listen. I knew him to be loving to everyone, devoted to Christ, and a person with a great sense of humor. I met with the family Friday night, and I asked them to just tell me about John, and they did. One of the things they told me is he was in a restaurant one time with the crew, and he spoke to somebody else that was there, and he said, do you like those potato chips? And they said, yes. And he said, would you like to have more of them? And they said, yes. And he reached over his great big hand, and he smashed them. And he said, now you have more. And then a fellow about 1.5 times bigger than John spoke up and said, those were my chips. And John turned around and looked at him and he said, I guess I owe you some chips. And he said, yes, sir, you do. He had a sense of humor that was special. I especially enjoyed and appreciated his communion and offering meditations. At Dover, we have communion every Sunday. When he would give the meditations, he didn't read them out of a book. They came out of his heart, and I appreciated that. He took them seriously. He put a lot of thought into them. One time for communion meditation, he came up here, and then he came over here. And he picked up a torpedo level. How many of you know what a torpedo level is? And he said, I'm a construction person. I build buildings. And it's always bothered me that frame is not exactly square. He had thought about it. He said, you know, sometimes our life is not exactly level. It's not exactly square. And we need a construction supervisor, Jesus Christ, to come and straighten us out and to help us. I still remember that. It wasn't off the cuff. He had picked up the torpedo level before he left home. And he had thought about it. And he had his heart prepared, and he prepared my heart for communion that Sunday. I remember another communion meditation he gave. He had Robin put a picture up on the screen of the new building at the Hennessy Public School. The domed building, is it the sports arena, the sports building? Is that correct? And he had been driving by at a particular time during the day, and as the sun would shine on the roof of that building, there was the perfect picture of a beautiful cross. And he told how he told Linda about it, and they went out together at the right time of the day, just a particular time, and you can see the cross on the top of the building. And from that, he extrapolated this point. He said, you can always find God around you if you'll look for him. I still remember that. He worked at doing a good job, not only in his construction of buildings, but in his service for the Lord Jesus Christ. He was the founder and president of D&D Construction, who manufactured and installed metal buildings. He was proud of his business. And he liked to tell you about it. He was proud that his only form of advertisement was word of mouth. His great joy was that customers became his friends. And his friends would then tell their friends where to go to get another building. And he was proud of that. He loved making customers into friends. His family said he worked hard, laughed a lot, and really cared about his customers and his crew. He taught not just a trade, but how to live. Like Chuck Kelly said, he was good-hearted, honest, loving. He wanted everything to be fair. The family said he hated dishonesty. One of the things he would do was pick up hitchhikers because they needed help. He would give them a meal, seldom money. He would take them where they needed, where they wanted to go. He liked fast cars. He owned some fast cars. He raced some fast cars, and he loved to go watch fast cars. And he loved to take his family and his crew with him to watch fast cars like NASCAR. He loved to travel with his family and his crew, like to Hawaii and to other places. He didn't always work in construction. One time, early in his life, he was a trash hauler in Corn, Oklahoma. How many of you know where Corn, Oklahoma is? He was a maker of boomerangs. He picked cotton. He was a hay hauler. He worked hard all of his life. He was proud that his father and John Denver's father were brothers, and so he, I think, was a cousin to John Denver. Two other things he did, he collected marbles. The family went to check the safe deposit box, and you know what they found in the safe deposit box? Marbles. He also collected baseball cards, and he has quite a few pretty good ones. But if John was here this morning, he'd say, don't tell them about my marbles, my base cards, and my race cars. Tell them about the Lord Jesus Christ. So I'd like to talk to you about maybe 10 minutes, and then we'll be through, about five fingers that grasp the hope of life after death. You know, five fingers are a full handful. And it comes from the scripture that Chuck has already read to you from 2 Corinthians. Paul said, I know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God. And since John was a constructor of buildings, I thought this was an appropriate passage of scripture. God is making a building out of you. God has made a building out of John. And it's not just made out of flesh and blood. It is a heavenly building that is designed for all eternity. And the scripture says you cannot just hope that. You can know that. Know beyond the shadow of a doubt. know with absolute certainty, know with positive truth that death is not the terminal end. There is something more, and you can grab a hold of it with five fingers so that you can know, and they're all in this passage of Scripture. And being just a Bible preacher, I always take you into the Word of God. And I'm going to show you the five fingers that grasp the hope, the certainty of life after death. One, he says, we groan, longing to be clothed with our heavenly dwelling. There is a longing and a groaning in the human heart for something more than we find here. We have all experienced it. And that is the first finger that grasps the hope of everlasting life, because that groaning, that longing, will be satisfied. God did not make you with a longing that will never be satisfied. You can see it in all of life. In the music scale, and I'm not really a musician, but there's do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti. And there's something in the human spirit that just screams. It says, put the da on it. Don't stop with ta. Do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti. Give it to me. Da. Everybody feels it. God made it in us. There's something to be completed. You can't just end on an E minor seventh. You know, an E minor seventh in music is a leading chord. It's a major chord with something wrong, something that's twisted. It's just not quite right. And you hear an E minor seventh, and the human spirit screams and says, give me the major chord that follows. You can't end on an E minor seventh. You've got to go to G and give me the full thing. We long for completion. God satisfies that desire. He didn't make you to just long and never find it. I've spent time by the bedside of dying saints, and I've heard them say, I just want to go home. That's not a death wish. That's a life wish. What they're saying is, what I'm doing here is not living, it's just existing. It's just a partial, it's incomplete, it's not finished. And I long for everything that God has for me that I haven't received yet. And that longing for life, that longing for health, that longing for happiness is the first finger that grasp the certainty of eternal life. We long for our building from God, and we groan to receive it. The second finger, hold up two fingers. The second finger that grasps the hope of everlasting life, it says in 2 Corinthians 5:4, so that mortality may be swallowed up in life. So that mortality may be swallowed up in life. Mortality is flesh and blood. Life is the eternal life that God has given us and provided for us. God so designed us so that one day you will throw aside your flesh and blood and be swallowed up, surrounded by true eternal life. You see, flesh and blood is our problem. Flesh and blood gives us cancer, tuberculosis, heart disease, cirrhosis of the liver, pneumonia, flu, COVID, migraine headaches, arthritis, diverticulitis, and on and on. The flesh and blood is our problem, and we long for it to be swallowed up in life. We try to make our life, our flesh and blood, better, and so we replace our falling out hair with wigs. our eyes that will no longer see with glasses, our teeth with bridges and false teeth, our ears with hearing aids, and our legs with canes and crutches, wheelchairs and power chairs. We try to fix flesh and blood, but we know it's just a temporary fix. It's not permanent, and we want to be surrounded by life. And Scripture teaches us that God will take away our problems of flesh and blood and usher us into life. Life as it was intended to be lived. And that swallowing up of the mortal, of the flesh and blood, with the eternal life is the second finger that grasps the certainty of everlasting life. Number three, hold up your third finger. The third finger, the text says, He who has made you for this very thing is God. This is a purpose statement. The purpose for which you were created was to live forever. And we have to understand the importance of purpose. Purpose is the intent of the designer for the work of his design. It is the intent of the creator for his creation. The purpose of a chair is what? To sit in it. The purpose of a gate is to open a space or to close a space. The purpose of a tractor is to cultivate, to pull a plow or a combine. The purpose of a car is to take you someplace. The purpose of a horse, I have no clue. But it has a purpose there somewhere, Max. And the purpose of a life is to live. You were not designed to die. You were designed to live and to live and to live forever. That is the purpose for which you were created by your Creator. God made you to live, to love, to feel, to share, to create, to give. Not for 20 years, 60 or 80, but for 6 million years. And at the end of that, you'll still be living. Somebody say amen. A devout Christian. A few months to live. Later that evening, when the man returned home, he walked out into his garden, which commanded a view of the river on one hand and a vast mountain range on the other. Turning toward the river sparkling in the moonlight, he said, River, long after you have ceased to flow into the ocean, I shall still be alive. Then his eyes turned to the mountains basking in the moon's soft glow, and he said, Mountains, long after you have been leveled, I shall still be alive. Then lifting his eyes upward, he beheld the diamond-studded sky. Stars, he said, long after you have become cold cosmic dust, I shall still be alive with my Savior. He who made you for this very thing is God. That's the third finger that grasp this promise, the certainty of life after death. Number four, hold up your fourth finger. Number four, He has given us the Spirit as a deposit guaranteeing what is to come. The Holy Spirit is a part of God. The Holy Spirit is God eternal. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. And when you were saved, God gave the Holy Spirit to live inside you as His deposit. deposit guaranteeing that you belong to Him. And Jesus said about the Holy Spirit, I will give you another counselor that He may be with you forever. Somebody say the word forever. The Holy Spirit is not with you for just a few moments or a few days, a few weeks or a few years. When you receive the Holy Spirit will be with you forever. And the Holy Spirit in you is one of the fingers that grasp the certainty of life everlasting. Paul said, if the Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, then the same Spirit that raised Him from the dead will raise you from the dead and give life to your mortal body. Number five. Put up your thumb, okay? You know, five, that's a full handful. You can grab and you can hold on. And the fifth finger, he says, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ to give account of the deeds done in the body. Note the word must. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ. Somebody that doesn't exist cannot appear. Somebody that is just recycling themselves in reincarnation cannot appear. Somebody who has been annihilated cannot appear. Somebody who is dead cannot appear. You have to be alive to get there. And you must appear, whether you like it or not. We're all going to appear before the judgment seat of Christ, and we are all going to confess our faith in Jesus Christ. If you have confessed faith in Jesus Christ here, your confession of Him there when you appear will be to your salvation. If you have refused to confess Him here, your confession there will be to your condemnation, but you will appear and you will confess Jesus Christ as Lord and you will be there. And you will receive what is due you. These five fingers are the way we grab a hold of eternal life. And we hold on. And we never let loose. We groan earnestly desiring, because mortality must be swallowed up in life. God has made us for this very purpose. The Holy Spirit is my deposit guaranteeing what is to come. And I must appear to give an account. Because of these five reasons, I know that John is not terminated. He's still alive. He's not here with us, but he's with the Lord. He can't come back to us here right now, but we can go to him. If we're still alive when Jesus comes back, well then John will come back with him and we'll meet him in that grand reunion in the air. We'll meet the Lord. And we'll meet John. For we must all appear. So John, we say goodbye. We say au revoir. We say see you later. Because we know that life is forever. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for Jesus Christ, who is our Savior. I thank you that He died on the cross, paid for the price of our sins, and was raised from the dead by the power of God to give us resurrection life, eternal life. Father, I take great confidence and joy in the fact that John Duchendorf had accepted Jesus as his Savior. He had been born again. He had been saved. He had been regenerated. He had become a child of God. He had received the Holy Spirit, and his name was written in your Lamb's Book of Life in heaven, so we know where he is, and we look forward to meeting him again someday. Father, I pray for anyone here this morning that doesn't have that certainty, that assurance, and that hope. Father, by your Spirit, speak to each one of us today. In Jesus' name we pray. And in Jesus' name we ask for strength and power and comfort. And all God's people said, Amen. Amen.